So today's scripture reading comes from John 24 through 35. Once a crowd realized that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they got into the boats and went to Capernaum in search of Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" Jesus answered, "I tell you the truth, you are looking for me, not because you saw miraculous signs, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. On him, God the Father has placed a seal of approval." Then they asked him, "What must we do to the works of God requires?" Jesus answered, "The work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent." So they asked him, "What miraculous sign then will you give that we may see and believe in you? What will you do? Our forefathers ate the manna in the desert, as is written. He gave them bread from heaven to eat." So Jesus said to them, "I tell you the truth, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." "Sir," they said, "from now on, give us this bread." Then Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty." We all have heard expressions referring to our guts, and we have said things like, "This is gut-wrenching. I felt it in my gut. I hope he doesn't spill his guts over this one. Now that takes guts." So on and so forth. These sayings and many more. We've even heard it said that our life depended upon our gut. And now we're here, a little less understanding of the meaning before us because we've heard it said before. But many of us have even heard it that it has been talked about in the Bible, about the source of life being sustained by our guts. What is it all, this talk about guts, and especially in relationship to Jesus and him being the bread of life? Well, guts are feelings, guts instinct, gut response, gut issues. They all mean different things to different people, and in different situations, the meanings can vary, like medical versus instinctional in scenarios. No matter, a hunger in one gut demands to be fed. On both meanings for sustaining life, venues on all accounts. It is bread, which is the world's basic filler food to quench the gut's hunger. And so it is we move with our discussion today. Before we delve into Jesus' phrase of being the bread of life in our text today, I'd like to open up by saying our guts are the key to our overall complete health. Jesus basically addresses the gut by saying he is a source of life which is to be fed for eternity, healthy, long-lasting life. You see, in our guts, our intestines, if you will, we have up to 30 feet of tubing for the average adult. There are 8 parts to the overall gut system within each of us. These parts each have a part and have a purpose for how it is that we are to be fed and kept alive. The mouth, the esophagus, the stomach, the small intestine, the large intestine, which is a colon, the liver, the pancreas, and the gallbladder, all must work together to keep us alive in digestion of food. Overall, there are 20 to 25 feet of this system in the small and the large intestines. Each one of us needs this system to be complete for us to be healthy. It is the way that we absorb and digest, gather our fuel for living. There are approximately, then, 100 trillion microorganisms or microbiota The primary responsibility for this system is digestion, absorption of nutrients, and the elimination of waste. Because of the importance of this biological system within each of us for the quality of life, we tend to have a lot of loaded meanings and expressions about our life support system, which we all have in common, no matter our differences among us. Our guts, in our guts, we humans unite. Well, in our text today, the people following Jesus after he had fed them because they wanted to find out more. They hungered to have more of their guts fed. Perhaps they had a new hunger surfacing after the initial physical feed, and those who followed Christ were trusting their gut for more in him. There are times in life to follow your guts, and that's a good thing. This is one of those times. Courage to find more is a survival instinct for us. And when our guts get appropriately fed, we continue to listen and obey. So there are some people who are known to think with their stomachs. To this adage, Professor Dago Bohorges, assistant professor of Duke Medical School, has said, "It is very simple organisms who do not have a brain. They have a gut." Evolution shows us that organisms were what populated and progressed into more complex systems for life to take root and develop and mature. 100 trillion organisms don't think. They eat, they breathe, automatically, so that we may begin to think as humans. You see, we eat 3 times a day at least, eating good foods and taking steps towards good, healthy living is what helps us with our quality of life and development. As far back as 1923, an ad in Bridgeton Telegraph said, 90% of the diseases known to man are caused by cheap foodstuffs. You are what you eat. Jesus would agree with this finding. You know, nowadays, many of us have become foodies and cookbook hound recipes. Cooking shows have boomed on TV and the internet, and we love to watch food being prepared. It feeds our senses. Whoever can help us make fast, easy foods, we tend to follow. But what kind of ratings do you suppose Jesus would get today? What might his Instagram following be at? Jesus, indeed, on the scene, reaching out, teaching people how to cook for life sustainability, long before the internet world. Jesus understood the 411 on feeding our heads, bodies, and our souls. Food that endures, food from heaven, true bread. Life sustaining without the preservations and chemicals which threaten our overall health. Jesus said, "For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Such bread doesn't taste delicious, but is actually giving life to the world." And so in response to Jesus' proclamation, people want his recipe. People want the chef of life to teach them how it is in their gut-saving recipe for their conception. Because like the intrigue of the next weight loss miracle, people do want the promise of good, tasty health. As it turns out, Jesus is the recipe of life that we all desire. We are to learn to ingest Jesus into our being, not a mere fanciful meal. Rather, we are to labor over the recipe of Jesus, our chef, into a way of life for the health and well-being of longevity that begins in our guts of reformation. This reform brings about forgiveness, new life with a message of guttural healing. The hunger of the gut is something Jesus seeks to feed within the entire community. The challenge for us is to become hungry enough and receptive enough to adapt to his palette of recipes provided for us. are we ready for this bread of Christ? If we begin practicing taking our food and thoughts from each of us in Christ each day and letting Christ heal our guts and digest this food that Christ gives to us, our taste will come around and begin to crave this source as our primary nutrition. In this reformation process of following Christ, we will find the walk with Christ takes less effort when we have the gut-fed nutrition of better quality than the cheaper foods we have grown accustomed to and which we have been ingesting. Good food sustains life. Like Guy is to the Food Network, Jesus is the chef of life for all of humanity. Faith and works are essential to Christian life as our flour and water to making a loaf of bread to satisfy our guts for the world. Unity in the loaf, communion for the world. The chef of life offers us the bread of life at the table of life, which is sustainable and green quality of living in our guts for the eternity of our souls now and to live onward. Through love and forgiveness with the Holy Spirit's presence, we find unity and a future of renewal, reconnecting and reuniting amongst life's changing scenes and for those who still are to come. 25 feet of guts helps us organize and thrive in this life, now, and that which awaits us beyond. It is in Christ which we can. Amen. On the night Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread and broke it, and he took the wine and poured it, and said, "This is the body and blood poured out for you for the forgiveness of sin. Take and eat and drink in remembrance of me until I come again." Let us bow for a word of prayer. Dear Lord, you are the bread of life and the well from which we are to drink from. Help us become more accepting and acquainted with your fuel for healthy living. As we eat and drink from you, may our taste become more acquiesced to your liking, that we may desire to draw from you for the nourishments of our life. As we go in this walk, let us fuel ourselves and minds upon the words which you have taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not in temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.